This time on Superstars, five celebrated beauties who found fame and fortune as models. Ten years after being crowned Miss World, Bollywood actress Aishwarya Rai was included in Time magazine's Top 100, the world's most influential people. Her crossover into Western cinema had been helped by the success of the 2002 lavishly produced film Devdas, which screened at the Cannes Film Festival. She sat on the festival jury the year after, and in 2004 she was back in India, promoting the Bollywood extravaganza Kyun Ho Gaya Na. The film, which translates as So It Finally Happened, paired her up with her real-life boyfriend Vivek Oberoi. Putting the romantic chemistry to the test on the big screen may or may not have been a draw card for audiences.
I think pairing would affect in bringing in the audiences, but I think the film in itself has to be good for the film to succeed. It's not a very dramatic, heavy film. It's a very light film.
Whatever the verdict, the couple's real-life romance wasn't headed for a happy ever after. For the next few years, Aishwarya threw herself into her career, starring in a Bollywood-style reworking of the Jane Austen classic Pride and Prejudice and becoming a spokesmodel for cosmetics giant L'Oreal. In 2006, it was back to Cannes to promote the controversial true story of a Punjabi woman who married an Englishman and moved to Britain. After 10 years of physical and emotional abuse, she finally murdered him and went to prison, before taking on the legal system and winning.
This was her story being told to the world at large, to all the Deepaks out there, to all the Kirans out there, and really to the families of all the the families and friends of the Kirans out there who probably would be otherwise worried, shy, closed and not unable to come out and tell their story.
Towards the end of the year, after making a late-night visit to a Hindu temple in Varanasi, she sparked rumours that she was set to marry Bollywood heartthrob Abhishek Bachchan. The pair became the Brangelina of Bollywood after steaming up the screen in Mani Ratnam's film Guru. Fans agreed there was plenty of on-screen chemistry.
The chemistry between them was good. I think so.
The couple's engagement was finally confirmed in January 2007 by Abhishek's father, Amitabh, who is hailed in India as the reigning king of Bollywood. The private wedding, which took place in Mumbai 3 months later, was turned into a national extravaganza by the Indian media. But then Aishwarya is accustomed to the spotlight. In 2004, her global popularity was honoured when she became the first Bollywood star to be cast in wax in London's Madame Tussauds Museum. And in 2007, her jet-setting likeness set off on a trip to the Big Apple.
She's an international star that supersedes everywhere, but she's Miss World and she happens to be coming here to New York for a short period of time.
Meanwhile, the real Aishwarya Rai has lent her profile to a wide range of good causes and campaigns. In 2004, she signed up to promote the Taj Mahal's chances of squeezing onto an updated list of the Seven Wonders of the World.
People all across the world absolutely treasure the love story of this monument, absolutely adore this monument, and without a doubt, it is one of the wonders of the world. It hasn't been documented. This is the one opportunity to do so. And what better year than the 350th anniversary of the Taj Mahal. So God bless, and here's wishing it on the list.
The wishing worked, and the Taj made the cut, along with the pyramids and the Great Wall of China. More recently, Aishwarya and her new husband and father-in-law took time out from attending an Indian cinema awards ceremony to visit a specialist charity center in Leeds. Back home in India, she donated her star power to the inauguration of a school for special kids. Originally from the Ukraine, Milla Jovovich has been dubbed the reigning queen of kick butt by cable music channel VH1, thanks to her penchant for portraying futuristic action heroines. The butt kicking started as a teenager, with her meteoric rise through the modeling ranks to become Miuccia Prada's muse and Gianni Versace's favorite supermodel without even trying. Despite topping the supermodel earnings list, she's since claimed that modeling has never been a priority and that she simply uses it to enable her to be selective about her creative decisions. In 1997, she starred along with Bruce Willis and Gary Oldman in Luc Besson's techno thriller, The Fifth Element. Playing the part of the perfectly proportioned clone Lilu involved getting about New York in a glorified bandage, courtesy of costume designer Jean-Paul Gaultier. The film was selected to open the 1997 Cannes Film Festival and won Milla nominations for Best Female Newcomer, as well as a Razzie Award nod for Worst Supporting Actress. The critics were equally split in response to her 1999 portrayal of French heroine Joan of Arc in the film, which won her another Razzie nomination and reunited her with director Luc Besson, from whom she'd recently become divorced.
For the souls of your men.
The butt-kicking continued in 2002 with the first installment of the horror action franchise Resident Evil, in which her character is forced to fight her way through the legion of zombies created by the less than sinister sounding Umbrella Corporation. Already a big fan of the video game series of the same name, Milla jumped at the chance to play Alice and threw herself into karate, kickboxing and combat training for the role and ended up performing most of her own stunts. The film was a blockbuster hit at the box office, and this time Milla's acting sailed under the radar of the Golden Raspberry Awards. She also got lucky on the love front, pairing up with the film's director and writer, Paul Anderson. She signed up for the Apocalypse sequel 2 years later, which required 3 hours fight training a day for 3 months. The film opened to mostly negative reviews, and Milla was said to be unhappy with the result. Still, she was grateful for the sizable pay packet that helped bankroll her smaller love projects. And when the final part rolled round in 2007, she cheerfully took to the red carpet to promote Resident Evil Extinction.
The Resident Evil franchise has been really fun for me, and I love doing action films, I love training, I love martial arts, so it's always a pleasure, you know, to work on such fun movies, and I love the video games, so, you know, it's always been something that I could really stand behind. And I think Resident Evil Extinction is really gonna be like the cherry on top of this franchise. So it was a really fun movie to shoot, very difficult, but at the same time, you know, everybody had a great time. It's a great cast of people, so I'm really happy.
No doubt, however, she was now looking forward to a chance to put her Resident Evil character to rest and prove to the critics that she has more to offer than a great body and some nifty moves.
You know, I love to experience lots of different characters and lots of different feelings. That's why I've had so many careers in my life, because I'm constantly searching for different things that make me feel good and help me express myself. So, you know, I think the sky's the limit with the possibilities.
And despite being 5 months pregnant, she was already looking way ahead.
I think motherhood is only the beginning for me, so I think for sure later on I'll do lots of things. Probably take a little break though to just be with my baby, but I'm sure it won't be the end of me with acting.
The break from the big screen might give her a bit more time to focus on her singing and songwriting career, which gave birth to her first album back in 1994. The Divine Comedy was labeled remarkable and strikingly mature and rich in invention by Rolling Stone magazine. Since then, she's contributed several songs to film soundtracks, but is yet to release another album. Other side ventures include running a production company called Creature Entertainment and a line of clothing in partnership with Carmen Hawke. Having opted to go to Paris to pursue a modeling career instead of going to university, Tyra Banks set a record, scoring 25 engagements in her very first week. She went on to have wildly successful careers in both print and on the runway. She regularly worked for labels like Bill Blass, Dolce & Gabbana, Christian Dior and Donna Karan. She's also one of the select few to have been chosen to spruik the wares of lingerie giant Victoria's Secret.
This is the very sexy push-up plunge bra. And it's really nice because it's good for small-breasted women because it gives you a push-up. It's also good for large-breasted women because it's not too lined. And then there's a thong here, thong, 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 with a little sexy cutout in the back.
She has also been the centerpiece of advertising campaigns for CoverGirl, Coors Light, and McDonald's. She has appeared on the covers of Vogue, Harper's Bazaar, Cosmopolitan, and Elle, and became the first African-American woman to adorn the covers of GQ and the Sports Illustrated swimsuit issue. One magazine she has stubbornly refused to pose for is Playboy, despite being inundated with requests from Hugh Hefner. She gave the modeling away in 2005 to concentrate on her television career, which had begun on the fourth season of The Fresh Prince of Bel-Air. However, in an interview with old rival Naomi Campbell on her own talk show, she spilled the beans on why she really retired from modeling.
To be honest, Naomi, I'm fearful of you to this day. Not right now. I feel safe. I feel like it's just me and you. There's not a lot of hoopla.
Right.
But even a couple of seasons ago, even a couple of years ago when we did the Victoria's Secret fashion show, and I walk in the room and I see you, I'm like, I start shaking. My heart starts beating faster. I go back to the 17-year-old girl.
Yeah, that you used to be.
That I used to be when this powerful, strong icon woman that I looked up to was terrorizing me. To this day, that's the story that I tell the press as to why I left the fashion industry.
The legend goes that the 14-year feud was kicked off by Naomi's insecurity. Believing that there was only room at the top for one black model, she supposedly set about sabotaging the younger model's career. If the stories are true, it seems that Tyra may have learned a trick or two from her quick-to-temper nemesis. The winner of the first series of America's Next Top Model, Adrienne Curry, recently spoke out against her as the host and creator, calling her Jekyll and Hyde. Adrienne explained that while the cameras are rolling, she can be the sweetest person in the world. But once the camera is off, she's Naomi Campbell in your face mean. She certainly seemed a little less than sincere in her sympathy when asked to comment about the death of Anna Nicole Smith in 2007.
She was on my talk show. Anna Nicole was on my talk show, and she was so sweet, you know, and she was a really sweet woman, and I'm sad that she's gone. I'm really sad.
Still, there is no shortage of viewers who are convinced of her charms. The Tyra Banks show attracts more than 1.9 million viewers an episode, which sells itself under the slogan, "Every woman has a story, and it happened to Tyra." Of course, she doesn't always mean that literally, especially when asking Heather Mills to share her experiences of dancing on one leg.
When you're dancing, do you ever have any like worries that my leg is gonna do something that it's not supposed to do?
Today, I am going.
However, she did go out and get some first-hand experience of being an exotic dancer. For one episode of her show, she was transformed into rookie stripper Chanel, donning a wig, fake teeth, a prosthetic nose, and a lot of makeup. Her undercover mission was to find out why men go to strip joints and what they get out of it. One topic of discussion she can truly relate to is the issue of weight and body image. Teased about her size as a child, Tyra was a pretty hefty teenager before slimming down to catwalk size. On America's Top Model, she's been a consistent advocate of body confidence, insisting that models don't need to be stick thin to be sexy. In 2007, the tabloids published an unflattering swimsuit shot of Tyra with a tagline, "America's Top Waddle." She hit back, saying, "I've made millions of dollars with the body I have, so where's the pain in that?" At a recent launch of Time magazine's list of 100 people who shape the world, the magazine's deputy managing editor paid tribute to her worthy crusade to combat body image problems in the fashion industry.
She, you know, she's not the only person, but she's probably been the most effective public person to sort of talk up, you know, the folly really of forcing our models to be this kind of irregular, unlikely sort of shape.
Gisele Bunchen's first ambition was to become a professional volleyball player. No doubt her accountant was happy with her eventual career choice, which has led her to become the highest paid model in the world. In 2006, Forbes magazine put her earnings total at an incredible $33 million, adding to her estimated $150 million fortune and making the Brazilian beauty the richest ever supermodel. Since becoming the Vogue VH1 Model of the Year in 1999, Gisele has dazzled designers and sponsors as much with her sparkling personality as with her stunning looks. As well as gracing the catwalks of Paris, Milan, London, and New York, she's been the face of countless campaigns for the likes of Christian Dior, Balenciaga, Dolce & Gabbana, Versace, Givenchy, Bulgari, Valentino, and Ralph Lauren. And on a contract worth $5 million a year, she was also a long-running spokesmodel for Victoria's Secret.
Sparkle's enough for me. Does this sparkle enough for you? Hi, this is Gisele. I'm here today at the Victoria's Secret photo shoot, shooting the new Victoria's Secret fantasy bra. Say hello to my little friend.
While she is happy to acknowledge the abundance of her own genetic blessings, Gisele has been quoted as saying that every woman is beautiful. And she stresses the importance of making the best of what we've got.
It's important for people to accept themselves just for their lives, you know, because you're going to live one life and you want to make sure that you're living the best you can. And if you don't like yourself, then you have to work at liking yourself. You know, I think that's an important thing. You don't want to live your whole life not liking yourself. So you have to, then something wrong with you that you have to kind of like think about it and say, you know, you have to, you know, validate yourself and actually, you know, see what are the things, because we all have faults and we all have good things about us. So you have to find the things that you find great about yourself. So
positive thinking is clearly not a problem for Gisele, who is just as at home filming an ad on a Brazilian beach as kicking a football with Arsenal striker Thierry Henry to help launch a new luxury watch brand.
So, but I really enjoy football. I really suck playing football, you know. So I wouldn't try, and I'm not very good at all. So I left that for the, you know, we have good players. We are taken care of, I think, you know, as far as like good players in our country. So
her ease in front of the camera has helped open the door to a possible new career as an actress. After making her movie debut in Taxi in 2004, she made a high-profile appearance in the 2006 blockbuster Devil Wears Prada as a bitchy assistant. She's also in line for a plum role in the follow-up to The Da Vinci Code. Perhaps Gisele picked up a few acting tips from her five-year romance with aviator Leonardo DiCaprio. Their on-again, off-again relationship finally ended in 2005, after which Gisele started dating surf god Kelly Slater. Meanwhile, she's been adding to her fortune by getting into bed with Brazil's largest shoe manufacturer, Grandin, to market her own range of sandalwear called Ipanema. And she can afford to plough a percentage of the profits back into preserving the groundwater sources in Brazil.
Oh, I feel proud that, you know, I go to work and I feel like I'm doing something good, and I can give money to something I believe in, and I can bring awareness to something that I believe. So that makes my job worth doing, you know?
And though she may come across as being very confident in the spotlight, when it comes to meeting people, she can be rather backward in coming forward.
I'm kind of shy, actually, when it comes to guys. You know, I'm kind of like, especially when you like someone, it's not like you're going to be looking at them. I'm kind of going to be like, oh, no, look the other way, you know? I'll blush, I think.
In our quest to hold on to the last vestiges of youth, no one feels the pressure more than female celebrities, especially when the foundations of their fame rest on the shifting sands of their physical beauty. Investing in a nip and tuck is one way to prolong the illusion of youth. Lying about your age is another. Depending on which biography you read, Italian sex symbol Monica Bellucci was either born on September the 30th, 1968, or on the same date 4 years earlier. While the star herself allegedly lays claim to the later date, childhood friends say she's 4 years older. Whatever the truth about her date of birth, sources agree on the place. She was born in Umbria in Italy. She began modeling at an early age to help finance her legal studies at university. But in the end, the law books lost out to the catwalk, and she moved to Milan to become one of the world's top fashion models. At the same time, she took up acting classes and made her first film appearance in a major English language film as one of the Toothy One's brides in Bram Stoker's Dracula. But the film that really got her noticed was 2002's Irreversible, which caused a furore at its premiere in Cannes. Played out in reverse, the film follows a drug-crazed vigilante, Vincent Cassel, bent on violent revenge against the twisted pimp who raped and disfigured his girlfriend, played by his real-life wife, Monica. The 9-minute rape scene and frequent use of anti-gay and misogynist expletives left many critics heading for the exit, while others praised its artistic merits. It's a film which is arousing a lot of controversy. There are lots of people who detest it, and people have had such a violent reaction to this film, and other people love it. I think that just for this reason, we did well to make it, because it's arousing controversy. I always thought that these three characters are like three flies, which are lost in space, in the sense that these are people who are trying to find a system in their life. They are trying to explain what life is, what death is, what sex is, what love is. But life is so much bigger than us. The following year, she starred as Persephone in Matrix Reloaded. Tired of the infidelity and arrogance of her husband, the Frenchman, she decides to go against him and lead Neo, Morpheus and Trinity to the Keymaker. After the heavy drama of Irreversible, working on a blockbuster action flick was a breeze. But the big bucks and excitement weren't the only draw cards.
For me, I mean, it was a great experience to be in this movie, really. Not just because it's a big American movie, but just because I had the chance to work with those incredible directors, the Wachowski brothers, and this incredible cast. Beautiful cast.
After playing Mary Magdalene in The Passion of Christ and the 500-year-old Mirror Queen in The Brothers Grimm, she was beginning to develop a reputation for jumping genres. In 2006, it was back home to Italy to play Baronessa Emilia Speciali in the offbeat movie Napoleon and I. Since then, her ability to speak Italian, French, Spanish, and English has kept film fans wondering where she'll pop up next. In 2008, she was in Cannes for the premiere of her latest movie, Sang Pazzo, based on a true story. Set in 1940s war-torn Italy, Monica stars as the ill-fated movie star Luisa Farida, and Luca Zingaretti plays Osvaldo Valenti, her infamous lover.
She was accused of dancing nude, naked in front of prisoners. He was accused of being a fascist, though he was actually more a rebel and nonconformist. The reality was he was addicted to cocaine and she was addicted to him. So it's a really strong, passionate story that has, as a background, a really important moment in Italian history.
The bodies of the two lovers were found on the outskirts of Milan on April the 30th, 1945, 5 days after Italy's liberation. Despite being well used to the glare of the spotlight, Monica was quite overcome by the reception.
A big emotion each time when you do the red carpet with all these people, all those photographs, and everybody crying, screaming. And so it's just a big emotion. And I'm not just an actor, I'm also part of the public, because when I see, when I look at an actor that I really respect, I'm moved.